I'm a flat earther. I've come out. The earth is absolutely flat. And I want my friends and family to understand why I believe that to be the case. Hi there, guys and gals. My name is Steve. I live in East Sussex. I'm 56. I've been married for 31 years. We have three lovely grown-up children who have all fled the nest. So we're living peacefully at home, just the two of us. I'm introducing this film about the flat earth. Personally, I want to introduce it because if ever I watch a film that could be considered to be contentious, I like to know who's behind the lens, who's making it, who's the person that's responsible for the video. I work in a family business, an electronics business down on the local industrial estate, and a lot of our work is designing and discussing PCB layout. A PCB has to be logical by design. Intricate, many parts, many components, and if you get those components in the wrong place, then the PCB isn't worth tuppence, it just won't work. And what I'd like to try and do in this video is to try and explain to my loving friends and family why is it that somebody who thinks logically believes the earth is flat. If we take a golf ball and we do a thought experiment, we traverse around the edge of the golf ball, at some point we're just going to fall off the side of the golf ball. If we take a tennis ball, exactly the same. Traverse, 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 fall off. Basketball, exactly the same principle. At some point we'll fall off. Same with an exercise ball. At some point will fall off the side. So why is it, when it comes to talking about the globe, that these logical principles just get discarded by our scientists and teachers? At some point, we are going to fall off the side of the globe. I remember asking the teacher, if I was to stand on the very top of the earth and I could get a 3 foot wide drill, and I just drill straight down through the earth, right through the core of the earth, right down through to the other side. If I have that 3 foot wide hole and I drop myself down into the hole and drop down and drop down and drop down and down, all the way through the core of the earth, out the way through to the other side, I will just end up appearing feet first out of that hole. I won't magically turn round halfway down that tunnel through the centre of the earth. I'll appear feet first down through that hole and just carry on dropping through as I reach Australia, drop down on through. And the teacher again just laughed and said, Steve, you don't understand, it's gravity that keeps us all in place. When I first heard that the earth could be flat and that taking a telescope and a calculator down to the coast would be the first step in demonstrating that to be the case, the very first thing I did was go straight out and buy a telescope, and I got a calculator, and I acquainted myself with conventional curvature mathematics, which tells us that given the curve of the Earth, at a distance of 10 miles, there will be a 32 foot drop, a measurable 32 foot drop minimum at a distance of 10 miles, which means that a boat at 10 miles distance from the shore should have its hull part obscured by 32 feet of water. So I took my telescope and my calculator. I looked at a ship that was 10 miles distance, looked at the hull, and could see that the hull was not obscured in the slightest by any water. Is it important whether the earth is a ball or whether it's flat? Does it really matter? I say yes, it does matter, because understanding the depth of deception around the teaching about the earth being round, that we live on a spinning globe, understanding that deception leads us into understanding that there are other deceptions that are taking place on this earth that the Bible warns us about very clearly and says in the latter days there will be deceptions that will deceive even the elect if that were possible. And I want my Christian friends and family to have the opportunity to consider these things, there's a quote that says, "The ultimate ignorance is the rejection of something you know nothing about and yet refuse to investigate." And what I would hate to have happen is that people just reject this message without actually looking into it. And more, what I'm realizing is that the Bible is becoming the only true word on this earth. The media is falling away, politicians are falling away. Everything that we held as dear and true is just turning to dust around us. And I'm realizing that actually God's word, when he says these things are going to happen, there will come a time when these things will come to pass, and they start to come to pass. More and more, I'm realizing that God's word be true and all else is false. I looked at the final edit and I thought, is this too long? And it isn't too long. And I hope that as you get into the film, you will understand why I've made it the length that I have. Because the one thing I've learned in looking at many, many Flat Earth videos is that they don't always address the key issues logically one at a time. And what can happen is that the viewer is left watching a piece of film whilst in the mind battling with an unaddressed issue. So what I hope I've been able to do in this video is to logically go through the issues that come up in a person's mind when they hear for the first time that the earth could be a very different shape than what they've been taught all these years. The Bible tells us that there's going to come a day when deceptions are going to come upon the earth that are going to deceive even the elect, if that were possible. And the Bible says, if that were possible, because it's not going to be possible, because God is going to raise up his prophets who are going to warn the people that these deceptions are coming on the earth. Therefore, it will not be possible to be deceived, because God will have it known that these deceptions are coming. And I believe that the shape of the earth that we've been led into believing that it's a globe is a deception that is just a foretaste of the deceptions that are going to come thick and fast as these days close in. I've used lots of original footage and I've chosen, I hope, lots of original music for you to listen to, and I would encourage you to watch this video and use earphones. I've designed this to be a totally submersive experience, and all I can say is that I've had an absolute ball, if that is the right word to use in this context. I've had an absolute ball making this video. I've loved every minute of it. It's blessed me no end. It's led me into research that has just blown my mind. And I trust that this video will bless you too. And I hope you enjoy it. And if you do, then please spread the word and the link far and wide. Thank you.
before I became a flat earth believer, I would have never taken the time to do this. I never would have thought to do it. I would have said, look, they're gone, the boat's gone, and went over the curve of the horizon because I was taught I live on a ball, spinning through space. And now I realize I don't. I was lied to.
Nambah ular ungana kuat. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Manned Spacecraft Center. This is the Apollo 11 press conference. The format today will consist of a 45-minute presentation by the Apollo 11 crew, followed by question and answers. At this time, I'd like to introduce the Apollo 11 crew, astronauts Neil Armstrong, Michael Collins, Edwin Aldrin. Neil?
It was our pleasure to have participated in one great adventure. It's an adventure that took place not just in the month of July, but rather one that took place in the last decade. We all here and the people listening in today had the opportunity to share that adventure over its developing and unfolding in the past months and years.
This is a story about giving everything we had to achieve something that hadn't been done before. So I hope in that you might find some food for thought. It was a journey, an expedition in Antarctica, the coldest, windiest, driest, and highest altitude continent on Earth. It's a fascinating place, it's a huge place. It's twice the size of Australia, a continent that is the same size as China and India put together. Our journey was, in fact, 69 marathons back-to-back in 105 days, an 1,800-mile round trip on foot from the coast of Antarctica to the South Pole and back again. In the process, we broke the record for the longest human-powered polar journey in history by more than 400 miles.
It's our privilege today to share with you some of the details of that final month of July that was certainly the highlight for the three of us of that decade. We're going to divert a little bit from the format of past press conferences and talk about the things that interested us most, in particular the things that occurred on and about the moon.
And one of the biggest things that I faced on Everest the whole time was this sort of fear and anticipation and suspense of the unknown, because I didn't know what to expect. I'd never really climbed mountains before, so I had no idea what I was getting into. And then a really interesting thing happened to me. It was sort of like all that fear washed away. Even though I was in this incredibly dangerous place, it was also this beautiful place and this fascinating place. And when you're in a situation like that, that's super dangerous, there's no control over the bad things that are going to happen to you. And so, in a way, I learned to let that go. Another thing I learned about Everest.
About the things that interested us most, in particular the things that occurred on and about the moon. We will use a number of films and slides, which most of you have already seen, and with the intent of pointing out some of the things that we observed on the spot, which may not be obvious to those of you who are looking at them here from the surface of Earth.
Just so you know, proud of those men. How freaking easy it would have been to say it's their night. How freaking easy. Excuse my language. Spectacular group of men. You go find them, you throw your arms around them, you give them a big kiss on the mouth if you're a girl. Wow, what a game! Ah, are you kidding me? When Odell Beckham was going up, I felt like a bowler at the bowling lane.
And slides, which most of you have already seen, and with the intent of pointing out some of the things that we observed on the spot, which may not be obvious to those of you who are looking at them here from the surface of Earth. The flight, as you know, started promptly. And I think that was characteristic of all the events of the flight.
Shortly before she'd warned her shore crew, conditions could lead to a capsize, but the record was now within grasp. Ellen MacArthur was poised to pass the finishing line and into the record books after a breathtaking display of skill and sheer courage.
Ellen, was there ever a moment when you just couldn't picture yourself getting back to this stage? It was just getting too hard.
There were some times out there that were excruciatingly difficult. There's no doubt about it. I have never in my life had to dig as deep as I did in this trip, and not just once or twice, but over consecutive weeks. I don't think I'll ever manage to communicate how difficult this has been. But certainly to come back here now and to look at it all in the past, it's amazing how time can heal things and the difficult moments turn to positive moments because you get through to the other side. And did I imagine I wouldn't be here? To be honest, I don't think I let myself, because you have to believe.
The flight, as you know, started promptly. And I think that was characteristic of all the events of the flight. The Saturn gave us one magnificent ride. Both into Earth orbit and on a trajectory to the moon. Our memory of that actually differs little from the reports that you have all heard from those previous Saturn V flights. And those previous flights served us well in preparation for this flight in the boost as well as the subsequent phases.
Yeah, absolutely everything. I was trying to hold my emotions back, but it's hard. I didn't see you cry much. You made me cry before the game. And I think it's just amazing to see emotion from this girl, because she's a warrior. I don't think any of you sitting here understand just what this girl puts herself through to be out on court, and just what she brings to the team. And
She inspires every single person that wears the green and gold.
The moments that happen, the fun moments, the challenges.
The bubble.
Yeah, just, you know, Lisa's funny little spaceship comments, and we were off to space. These last Com Games were climbing Mount Everest, and this one we were heading out of space and
new frontiers.
We would like to skip directly to the translunar coast phase and remind ourselves of the chain of events, that long chain of events that actually permitted a landing, starting with the undockings, the transposition and docking sequence.
First Olympic memory growing up, I think it was probably the 1984 Olympics in Los Angeles, and it wasn't actually a performance that kind of stuck in my mind. It was actually seeing floods of tears, and I remember that just striking this kind of thought in my head of, like, what must be going through their minds right now? Why are they so emotional? You know, what could reduce you to tears? Kind of getting my head around the fact that actually they're probably quite happy, and it's not because they're sad. But that's the one thing I remember about the Olympic Games. I think it was athletics, seeing various podium presentations and seeing grown men in tears, which, you know, ironically, that was me a number of years later. But I think it showed me that there was something so powerful that these athletes had been determined to achieve, that when it had happened, they were just clearly overawed by it.
The various messages that were sent up to us, the whole host of numbers for the particular maneuvers that were coming up that we would copy down, we'd log these on that sort of a data sheet.
Many of us and many other people in many places and speculate on the meaning of this first landing on another body in space. Would each of you give us your estimate of what is the meaning of this to all of us?
To put Diana's swim into context, there are 16 million people who do open water swimming. There's 116 people who've actually swum over 24 hours straight. But to go over 48 hours, that's only 12 people in the history of the world that have actually swum that long, that far. Of those 12 people who've swum over 48 hours nonstop, Diana Nyad's in a venue where there's box jellyfish, where there's sharks, where there's the fastest and largest moving body of water in the world, and she goes 52 hours plus. Unprecedented.
Would each of you give us your estimate of what is the meaning of this to all of us?
You want to try that?
How can you?
Well, I believe.
believe that what this country set out to do was something that was going to be done sooner or later, whether we set a specific goal or not.
Find a way. You have a dream, and you have obstacles in front of you, as we all do. None of us ever get through this life without heartache, without turmoil. And if you believe and you have faith and you can get knocked down and get back up again, and you believe in perseverance as a great human quality, you find your way. And Bonnie grabbed my shoulders and she said, let's find our way to Florida. And we started. And for the next 53 hours, oh, it was an intense, unforgettable life experience. The highs were high, the awe. I'm not a religious person, but I tell you, to be in the azure blue of the Gulf Stream, as if as you're breathing, you're looking down miles and miles and miles, to feel the majesty of this blue planet we live on. It's awe-inspiring.
It might be timely at this point to think in many other areas of other missions that could be accomplished.
When you achieve your dreams, it's not so much what you get as who you have become in achieving them. And yeah, I stand before you now. In the 3 months since that swim ended, I've sat down with Oprah, and I've been in President Obama's Oval Office. I've been invited to speak in front of esteemed groups such as yourselves. I've signed a wonderful major book contract. All of that's great, and I don't denigrate it. I'm proud of it all, but the truth is, I'm walking around tall because I am that bold, fearless person. And I will be every day until it's time for these days to be done. Thank you very much, and enjoy the conference. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Find a way.
Would each of you give us your estimate of what is the meaning of this to all of us?
I just see it as a beginning. Not just this flight, but in this program, which has really been a very short piece of human history, an instant in history, the entire program. It's a beginning of a new age.
Neil, how much descent fuel did you have left when you actually shut down?
My own instruments would have indicated less than 30 seconds, probably something of 15 or 20 seconds. I think the analysis of made here on the ground indicates something more than that, probably greater than 30 seconds, 40 or 45. That sounds like a short time, but it really is quite a lot.